that to your conversion. I want you to think back to the point in your life where you remember distinctly God getting a hold of you. Now, if you're like me, you grew up in the church. So there may or may not be one of those points. I want you to think back to the point in your life where you were converted and nothing could shut you up about the message of Christ. You remember that? Right after you were converted, you were so adamant about what had just happened that you had to share it with everybody that you knew. You remember back to that point? Maybe you're still like that, but if you're like me, we wax and we wane. We get comfortable. The fire has diminished and we get comfortable and we start thinking about how to evangelize. We start thinking about how to share the gospel. And that's what gets us into trouble. The fire diminishes because our brains get in the way. The sermon series that we're going to start today is a 7-week sermon series on the 7 churches in Revelation. And this is going to directly come from the book of Revelation. And on the map behind me, I got this map because it's nice to see on a map where we're talking about. Because I'm a math kind of guy. If you can't see this one up here, there's one back on the back, too, if you want to turn around and look at that one, too. But what we're going to do is we're going to go through the Revelations chapter 2 and 3, where Christ tells John to write down these letters to the 7 churches, and that these need to be delivered. And we're going to talk about each one of these letters over the 7 weeks. Today we're going to focus on the letter to Ephesus, Revelation 2, chapter 1, chapter 2, verse 1. And while you're flipping to that page, I have to explain something to you. Revelation is a very symbolic book, and there are two terms in here, 3 terms actually, where there are a little bit of confusion sometimes. One of the very first lines, it says, to the angel in the church of Ephesus, and then he talks about stars, okay? The angel and the stars are what we think are the leaders of that church, or the leader, the minister of that church. In the passage as well, there's a lampstand. The lampstand is the church, okay? So as I read that, think about that as I read this. Revelation 2, verse 1. To the angel of the church in Ephesus, write, the Holy One who holds the 7 stars in his right hand and who walks among the 7 gold lampstands says, I know your works, your labor, and your endurance, and that you cannot tolerate evil. You have tested those who call themselves apostles and are not, and you have found them to be liars. You also possess endurance to have tolerated many things because of my name, and have not grown weary. But I have this against you. You have abandoned the love you had at first. Remember then how far you have fallen. Repent and do the works that you did at first. Otherwise, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place unless you repent. Yet you do have this. You hate the practices of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. Anyone who has an ear should listen to what the Spirit says to the churches. I will give the victor the right to eat from the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God. The church in Ephesus, including here in Revelation, is mentioned 17 times in the New Testament. 17 times. Out of the 7 churches in Revelation, Ephesus is mentioned more times than any in the New Testament. Now, not only do we have the letter here in Revelation to Ephesus, but we also have several instances in Acts, and we also have the letter to the Ephesians that Paul have two more letters, 1st and 2nd Timothy. Paul wrote the letters of 1st and 2nd Timothy to Timothy when he was at the church in Ephesus. So we have a lot of information on what was going on with the church of Ephesus. Ephesus, as you can see here on the PowerPoint here, that little red mark right there, that is where the church of Ephesus is. Now, when John wrote the letter to Revelation, he was here on Patmos, right there. Ephesus is right there. And then the seven churches are as follows in this kind of circular order. Ephesus, oh man, I can't even read that. Smyrna, Pergamum, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea. So the letter kind of circulated around. Ephesus is a seaport. It is right there on the edge. Now, right there, right here is Ephesus. Greece is right over in here, about where the stained glass window is. And Italy is about where the edge of the baptismal is. So it is a huge port. It is a very, very important port, and it is very culturally diverse. And not only that, it had a prominent status in the area. And we can see back to the, I'm going to reference Acts 19, 21 to 41, but I'm not actually going to read it. In Acts here, we find the temple of Artemis. And this is the instance where Paul goes in preaching and the silversmiths get upset with him. Because these silversmiths are making money off of the temple, like lots of money. And the silversmiths get mad and start a riot and try to rush Paul out of town, and actually works. He ends up going to Macedonia because of it. But that was in Ephesus. In this letter, Christ is telling Ephesus here in Revelation that they once had a great love for Christ and a great love for Christ, for God's people. In Ephesians 1:15-16, I will read these two short verses. 1:15-16, Paul writes, "This is why, since I heard about your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all the saints, I never stopped giving thanks for you as I remember you in my prayers." The church in Ephesus was adamant in their devotion to Christ, and they were adamant in their devotion to God's people when they first started out. However, it is a stark contrast between when that church started and where that church is currently in Revelation. My theory is this. The church was started in around 50, between 50 and 60 AD, or I believe it was around 55 AD. John wrote the letter to Revelation in 90 AD. 40 years have passed. The church at Ephesus is no longer those first Christians. It is a second generation Christian church. And one of the first, second generation. You see, it had a history, a long history. A long history is 40 years, but they're second generation believers. The problem was is that these second generation people lacked a deep devotion to Christ and for God's people. from there, the ball just went downhill. My parents got divorced when I was 16. I started floundering, making very, very bad decisions. And as these things started happening when I was 12, I began to own my faith. My dad had cancer. That'll wake you up. That will really wake a guy up, especially at 12.
The thing is, Christ doesn't just want our conformity.
He doesn't just want us to fall in line. He also doesn't just want our service. He wants your love. That's what he wants. In other words, he doesn't just want the conformity. He doesn't just want the head. He doesn't just want the hands for service. He wants your heart. That's what he wants. He wants your heart. He wants the heart.
Christ is telling this church in Ephesus to repent. He is telling them to remember how far they've come.
He's telling the second generation of believers to remember what their parents had taught them and how far they've fallen from grace.
It's not that they don't believe. They do believe. But they're having trouble with faith and grace.
That's what's missing from the Ephesian church is faith and grace. They miss the point. He knows their words. He knows labor. He knows their endurance. But they're missing faith and grace. That's the two most important parts of the gospel. You're missing faith and grace. You're missing faith and grace. You're missing the whole picture.
The love we have for God should be far above anything else in our life.
The love that we have for our wife or husband or our family should pale in comparison to the love that we have for God. And that's exactly what Christ is telling this church.
Your love for Christ and your love for other people has fallen. Christ isn't just asking for an attitude change. He's asking for an affection change too. He's asking for an attitude change and an affection change. It's about serving Christ because we want to serve Him. Not because we should serve Him. Not because we have to serve Him. Not because Mom and Dad said so, but we should serve Christ because we want to serve Him. Because we love Him that much.
Christ is blatantly warning this church that if they do not repent, the lampstand will be removed from them. You remember what I told you the lampstand was? That's the church. If you do not repent, this church will be taken from you. Christ is blatantly warning this. I mean, right there. He says it in verse 5. Remember then how far you have fallen. Repent. There's the first repent. And do the works you did at first. Otherwise, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place unless you repent. There's the emphasis of the repent there. If they don't turn and start loving Christ and loving others, the two commandments that Christ gave in the Gospels, then the church is going down.
Let me give you a little historical history on the church at Ephesus. What happened to it through the years. The site of the Ephesian church was where the Council of Ephesus was in 431 AD.
Now, over the first few centuries, they had these councils where they gathered together to try and put off the heresies that were being taught. They gathered together to decide doctrine. That's what these councils were about. There were several of them over the years. Well, the Ephesian church, one of the first churches started in Asia Minor, was the host of this thing. It was the church at Ephesus. So they were at least around for four centuries. But shortly after this council, that area started to go down, and I mean rather quickly.
century. 7 centuries this place has been barren. No cities, nothing. Christ says that if you do not repent, your church will be taken from you.
Anybody know what country this is?
It's okay to speak up if you know. Anybody know what the country is? Yeah, it is Turkey. What's the primary religion of Turkey? Yep, they're Muslim. Have I made my point yet?
This isn't just about a church. This is about a country. Christ says that if you do not repent of your ways, your church will be taken from you, but not just the church. The entire town, but not just the entire town. I'm going to give it over to a religion that has nothing to do with me. Sound like America? We need a revival. We need a wake-up call.
And this sermon isn't just for this church. This sermon needs to be heard everywhere.
Because we in American culture have got to wake up. But you know what? If we try to save our country, it's too big of a task. You know where it starts? Right here.
It starts right in our own backyard. Because my fear, maybe we won't become Muslim, but we're heading to a new age, atheistic kind of country. That's where we're headed. We're headed towards a conglomeration of so many different ideas. I don't talk politics from the pulpit, but I don't like our presidential choices coming up. I don't like either one of them. One's a Mormon who's not a Christian. I don't know about the other guy. I just try not to touch that subject.
But the point is, if we stick truly to our faith and our grace, if we repent and turn back to the love that we have for Christ and the love that we have for other people, the desire to work for the Lord will develop. The desire will be there. Because you're going to understand and you're going to begin to own that faith and grace that you had trouble understanding at such a young age. It is so hard for a kid to own the faith. Abe wants to be baptized, and I am very hesitant to baptize her because she doesn't... I've been there. I couldn't own my faith because I hadn't done anything. What have I done? What had I done?
And once I reached that age of accountability, I began to understand. I began that journey on owning my faith, and it wasn't until I was 25 where I fully came around and was like, oh my goodness, what am I doing? I got to a point where I didn't want to step foot in a church. The Lord was going to develop us as we walk on. Faith and grace are the beginning point. All who believe in Christ as their Savior will have the right from the tree of life. And I had to look it up. I'm sitting here going, tree of life. Tree of life. Wait a minute. The tree of life is from the Garden of Eden. Adam and Eve ate of the tree of knowledge, of the knowledge of good and evil. And God sent them out of the garden because he didn't want them to live forever in their sin. I don't want them to eat of the tree of life. Get them out of the garden.
Standing here in the pulpit telling you to do it. It's not about legalistic
observation of laws and rules and traditions and regulations. It's about relationship. It's about relationship.
From the very first word to the very last word, this book is not about laying down the law. It's about relationship. It's a story of how God loves humanity enough that he even thought to create us in the first place. He wanted somebody to talk to for his enjoyment. And then it has been the relentless pursuit of you and me ever since. It's all about relationship. That's what everything in that book boils down to, is relationship. Christ said it best. Love God, love others. That is what the gospel is. Come to Christ. Love God. Love others. And it's about doing things out of a desire to please him simply because you love him. That's what it's about. It's about relationship. And my friends, if you haven't begun that relationship with him, I want to urge you to start today. But don't expect something to change immediately overnight. You're going to still wake up tomorrow morning. You're still going to be the same person doing the same things that you did before. Only this time, you're going to try and work to correct that. It's not some magical pill. It's a process. I've been on that process my entire life. I struggle with that. Was I saved when I was going to the Catholic Church? I had a relationship with him, so yeah, I kind of think I did. But I fell away because I couldn't own my faith. I had to go through that trial in order to figure out why I needed to be saved in the first place. I hadn't owned it. It's about relationship. If you're on that journey today, if you've already started that, if you struggle to relight that fire, I've had several instances over my life that have reignited that. When I first went back to church back in 04, I had another one when I finally submitted to being a minister. I'd given my life to Christ, but I didn't give it totally because I didn't want to be a minister. But when I fully gave my life over to him to becoming a minister is when my life really changed. And that fire ignited. And I got another ignition when I went to the walk to Emmaus. And I'm going to plug it because I guarantee it will relight your fire. And anybody who's been on that walk that's sitting in this room, they can affirm it. The Emmaus walk will reignite your fire. It'll bring that passion back. And sometimes we need that passion to be returned because we just get comfortable. It's human nature. My prayer is that this morning that we work on the relationship with him, that we continue this journey together. We encourage one another and build each other up so that we can reach the people in this community that need to be reached.